It is not a Shakespeare question, despite his sonnet 59. If there be nothing new, but that which is hath been before, how are our brains beguiled? How are our brains beguiled? For some, a book is a monument consecrated to knowledge, human experience, and creation. Without a doubt, it is a door to communication and debate. Stendhal said it was like a mirror of the reality, which is debatable, taking into account that the writer's narrative always prevails, no matter how objective he would like to be. Gustave Flaubert spent more than 10 years writing, rewriting, changing his magnum opus, Madame Bovary. He is said to have sometimes spent a whole day completing a single sentence, or even finding the right word. And yet, his book is not a clean mirror of subjectivity. When I was young, the slightest trace of use on a book seemed like a sacrilege to the human artistry creation. A book seemed to me to be a sanctuary of knowledge, and it should not be violated even with the delicate touch of a feather, much less marked. So annotate was an obscenity in the reader's language. I saw a book as a common object of human knowledge. I have to preserve it. I have to read it almost without touching it, and finish it with the promise that others, upon seeing it, would believe that it was still virgin to the sacrilegious hands of any reader. In short, the book had a second life for the others. How wrong I was. Books do not have a second life. They have one. Yours as a reader. That is unique, singular, sensitive only to your experience and knowledge. My library then seemed like the consecrated corner of unread books, eagerly awaiting for a reader. Time has passed, and age, life, and experience have told me that a book is personal and does not belong to a community of readers, but to myself. It is an object for personal use, like a shirt, any other valuable object, your most intimate feelings, and it must be handled, open, stripped of its conventional virginity, and annotated if necessary. If you want to preserve the first review for posterity or the next reading, how you read a book is how you move throughout your life in daily events. If you don't stop and annotate, you get lost in the diary of time. You turn the page without finishing. Today, I annotate, write, paste notes in books. I attach the stickers and markers. I underline phrases, frame with colors and ink its pages. A book is no longer virgin because it is mine. It does not have to preserve any conventional virginity, because it does not have a monk's conviction. It is my intellectual property, not anyone else. It is the memory of my journey through its pages, its world, its erudition. Annotating is not a whim, but a necessity of the intelligent reader who hopes to review the work again, rewrite it to his way and understanding. Flaubert is no longer Flaubert, but Flaubert and I, and the next I in the second, third, and penultimate reading. And I write frantically on each pages, and I cross out what myself I already wrote. A book is not a manual, nor a diary in the sense of daily human experience. but it is a diary of a revisited reading of its pages over time. The annotation is the reader's need to understand its pages, of the doubts and questions he asks the first writer. Because a book is born from a writer and is delivered to the hands of the reader so that he can rewrite it in his own way, in his vision, and in his personal understanding of the original written story. And that's why he needs the annotation. Flaubert never thought in that way, because his knowledge, recognition, and understanding of literature had an authoritarian character of univocal possession. That's why he wrote, re-elaborated a phrase, a word, and took a week to finish one sentence. He didn't want anyone to change anything. He was that little tyrant of words and anecdotes who wanted to know freedom for the reader. But he failed, because literature only has logic when it has a first life, while it is written by its author, who creates a story and launches its original existence. And it is reinvented and rewritten when it falls into the hands of the reader. At least great literary works have many rewritings. On the other hand, the mediocre ones do not admit neither annotation nor reinterpretation, much less rewriting, despite the fact that many of them become bestsellers in the publishing market. Open Anna Karenina by Leo Tolstoy, and you will see how your first reading changes when you begin your second or third. What you did not see in the first review, you will notice in the second. And in that hidden phrase, when Bronsky visits Anna for the first time, you will discover the sexual meaning that Tolstoy never says, but suggests, hides between words. You wonder, what happened there? Why does Tolstoy pause there? What's he left out saying? If I annotated the first time with a question, the second time you will find the answer, and you will discover that the story navigates a different path thanks to that pause that caused your first note. None of this, for example, happens with 50 Shades of Grey, a mediocre book impossible to annotate because it is not literature. Yes, I annotate today with frenzy sometimes, and sometimes with the uncontrollable taste of understanding that if there is a second chance, what I annotate will serve as an initial compass for the rediscovery of a new vision of what I have read, or its reaffirmation, which is also valid. Good literature insatiably demands annotation. Bad literature is just a waste of time. But what to annotate? This depends on each book, type of literature, author, and above all, each reader. Each book has its complexity or lack of complexity. Each type of literature, genre, type of narrative or poetry has its annotation identity. There are cryptic authors like James Joyce. Ulysses is not only cryptic because of its language, but also because it references a city that most of us do not know, a city that no longer exists today as Joyce described it in the book. And also because the characters in the story make rather obscure reference to others in classical literatures and to passages from it. This type of book requires many annotations. Many if you do not know the classics it refers to, and also because precisely you know them very well. The act of annotating is also an act of reaffirming prior knowledge. The Lord of the Rings, although it is not Joyce, also requires annotations to the richness and variety of characters, stories, and languages, but not precisely because of the literary language that Tolkien uses, as is the case with Joyce. Sometimes, for instance, Tolstoy is consciously obscure in what he writes, so that the reader asks himself what he is hiding or, at least, what he hasn't said. Human beings are not totally transparent. We all always have something cryptic in our personality. But also, the circumstances in which Anna Karenina was written have changed. And how obscure a passage may be for us today may have been very different and clear at his time. For instance, I'm very invested in seeing the choice Dickens makes of expressions and words in certain passages of Bleak House. Or, to give a clear example, in the case of George Eliot in Middlemarch, when she used dunderheaded instead of stupid in chapter 45 to describe Dorothea, a word that is derogatory but not overwhelmingly negative, like stupid. Other times, I find important to note references to characters, expressions, and situations from other classics, such as Shakespeare. I annotate them because, on many occasions, I go and reread that particular passage, and thus I see the contrast of how Eliot, or Tolstoy, or Dickens use it, compared to how Shakespeare originally wrote it. And the conclusion I reach, I leave annotated for the next time, if the rereading happens again, because my opinion may change. At that second or third time, I don't remove the first note. I just cross it out slightly and write my new observation. It's a kind of diary of re-annotations, just let's say it. In the case of translations, for me it is almost mandatory to annotate. Some of the books I have reread in English, I previously read in my native language, Spanish. And many times, if not always, I find many limitations in one or the other language, if not in both. It happened to me a lot, for instance, in the case of Anna Karenina, where the English translation of Tolstoy's work makes an excessively mediocre use of words like base with the meaning of low or vile. Annotating, furthermore, is learned over time. The experience and culture of reading help us improve the quality of the annotations. One conclusion becomes evident. Annotating is reading in depth. It is not taking a literature course, nor undertaking a literary appreciation class. It is reading with intelligence and depth, the only possible way to value good literature. Does it mean that if I don't annotate a book, I read wrong? No, it is just that you do not do it to its full potential. There are no clear instructions to learn how to annotate. Only the will and desire to do so helps you start and continue. There are books that cannot be annotated on their first reading. Tolkien's The Lord of the Rings is one of them. It is not because it is difficult. It is clearly not Finnegan's Wake by Joyce. But Tolkien needs the reader to read the appendices to The Lord of the Rings, as well as The Hobbit and The Silmarillion, in order to begin rereading and do some proper annotations, if you wish to do so, or to value his work in all his depth. After all, you don't have to annotate a book just for the sake of exercising the literary annotation mania. So, in conclusion, we can say that the option to annotate or not is simply that, a choice, a very personal choice. It is entirely up to you to choose it. I wonder if you will.